30 years ago, a handful of people working on the third floor of a radio station brought Wilmington and the Eastern Carolinas into the television age. Friday, April the 9th, 1954, Channel 6, then WMFD-TV, signed on and broadcast a total of 5 hours. Good evening, I'm Bill Thompson. Tonight, we're going to look at some of the people, programs, and events you've watched on WECT, as well as take a behind-the-scenes look at the way television and WECT have changed since 1954. WECT is 30 years old this month, and we'd like to invite you to celebrate with us. If you've watched WECT over the past 30 years, you've probably seen this man. My co-host on Carolina in the Morning, Wayne Jackson. Wayne came to Channel 6 just 5 months after we went on the air.
Right, Bill. Back in September of 1954, a long time ago, I arrived in Wilmington fresh from a job in radio, very young and naive, no television experience whatsoever, and then went on the air 2 days later.
That sounds like me when I started on Carolina in the Morning just 7 months ago. I'm glad one of us has had some experience in this business.
You know I can be found. It was a different world 30 years ago. Ike was president. The country was settling into what became the fabulous 50s. Wilmington was much smaller then. The first state ports terminal had just been built. The headquarters of the Atlantic Coastline Railroad was still downtown. And the first sales brochure published by Channel 6, then WMFD-TV, bragged that Wilmington was a leader in the South's industrial progress. And in 1954, Wilmington had 3 newspapers, 2 radio stations, and 1 television station. Channel 6 was only the 7th TV station in the state of North Carolina. When WMFD began broadcasting in April of 1954, there were probably fewer than 10,000 television sets in its entire viewing area. The first hour or so of every broadcast day consisted of the test pattern. People adjusted their sets to the pattern so they wouldn't miss any of the programs on WMFD.
Well, my first business trip to New York for the television station was to secure delayed broadcast network programming that we were offering to run free just to give our viewers network programming to fill some of the slots that we had voids in. We really didn't have enough programming to program a full day. We were fortunate. On my trip, we secured the Colgate Comedy Hour and several other programs of that nature that provided some basically good entertainment for the people in our service area. It really made no difference to the people that the programs were on a delayed basis because the programs were very current to our viewership. And it did compose good programming, and it was available only on a delayed basis. Probably the only problems we had in television back in those days, and the only controversy, was in reception, not in programming.
We did a number of live shows from WMFD studio on Princess Street. One I remember in particular was called TV Song Shop. We played records and aired films of musicians performing. Michael Jackson, who says music videos are new?
Another live show on Channel 6 was a weekday afternoon talk show called Relax with Jax, hosted by a very young Wayne Jackson.
Probably one with hair, too. I talked to anyone who had anything interesting to say on practically any subject. One of the most interesting guests was baseball star Jackie Robinson. And one of the nicest things about those early days was the fact that we could do anything we wanted. Nothing had ever been done before. Sometimes we opened Relax with Jax with man on the street interviews. We only had one camera at the station then, so to do this, the engineers took the camera apart in the studio, carried it down to the street, put it back together again. Then we ran microphone and camera cable out one of the windows, stopped people on the street. Some of them wouldn't stop, though. They ran across the street to get away from us. And then we talked to them on television. And then while a 15-minute soap opera was on, and all soaps were 15 minutes then, we hustled the camera upstairs, the engineers put it back together in the studio, and we went on with Relax with Jax from the studio set. The technology of television has probably changed more over the past 30 years than anything else. When Channel 6 went on the air, the station had only one studio camera, two film projectors, and a slide projector. Everything people at home saw on Channel 6 was either live or on film. And before we joined the network, everything originated from the Princess Street studio. That all changed in 1955 when we became part of the NBC television network and broadcast live NBC shows from New York.
When you turn on your television, you probably don't wonder how the network signal gets into your home, unless the signal isn't getting into your home because of technical difficulties. When we became an NBC affiliate in 1955, the signal came to Wilmington on telephone lines. Then we broadcast the signal from our transmitter. The telephone lines cost the station a lot of money, so we had to find another way to get the network signal. In 1958, we found another way. WECT became one of the first television stations in the country to receive the network signal via microwave relay. This is a microwave relay repeating tower. It's part of the system that brings us our network signal today. The signal comes from New York or Atlanta to Raleigh, and from there, it's beamed from tower to tower until it reaches the station. Within the next few weeks, our network signal will be sent to us via satellite.
Another aspect of television that has changed tremendously through the years is our ability to broadcast from places other than our studio. We call these remote broadcasts, or remotes for short. Our first remote was the 1955 Azalea Festival Parade. We took our one camera out of the studio, stretched camera cable over several rooftops to the platform we had set up. And then in 1961, WECT taped a basketball game in Brogdon Hall. We had two cameras by then, and a remote truck that housed the director, engineer, and audio person. The two cameras we used to tape the game were the studio cameras. Those were the only video cameras WECT owned. And for the dedication of the Cape Fear River Bridge in 1969, we were still using our studio cameras, but by then we had a mobile television studio, fashioned from an old blue Wilmington city bus. Remotes go on in all kinds of weather, too, often with little more protection for talent and equipment than an umbrella and a plastic bag. Remotes today are very different from remotes of the past. For one thing, we no longer have to use our studio cameras. We have mini cams that give us broadcast quality pictures like studio cameras, but they're small enough to fit on a camera person's shoulder. WECT broadcasts live from the Azalea Festival, the Dogwood Festival, the Sun Fun and Strawberry Festivals, the Sampson County Expo, and Christmas parades from all over our coverage area.
The reason we can bring you the programming you've come to expect from WECT is the support we've received over the years from our advertising clients. Our first day on the air, we ran 12 commercials. Today, we average between 250 to 350 commercials per day.
And like everything else in the early days, commercials were either on film or done live in the studio. When the spot was live, the announcer had to be in the studio to do the commercial, regardless of what time it was. That often meant coming back to the studio at night to do the commercials, and that wasn't a whole lot of fun, believe me. And there were mistakes. I remember after Carolina won the national championship in basketball in 1957, we cut to Bob West to do a commercial. He was in the studio. All Bob could say, being a diehard Carolina fan, was, "We're number one. We're number one."
Today, WECT does a great deal of commercial production. Members of our staff write, shoot, and edit spots for many of our clients. And thanks to videotape and cart machines like this one, announcers like me don't have to come back at night to do commercials. An engineer simply places the cart in the machine, pushes the button, waits for it to queue up, and the spot runs. In 1808, the forest and marshes of southern North Carolina became Columbus County. Traditionally, WECT has depended on local clients for its livelihood. That's as true today as it was in 1954. And we'd like to thank our clients for advertising with us. You've made it possible for us to serve the people of the Eastern Carolinas for 30 years.
1957 was an important year for Channel 6. In June, we moved our transmitter from the top of WMFD AM's radio tower to our own tower in Delco, North Carolina. Then, in October, the station was purchased by the present owners, the Atlantic Telecasting Company. That led in 1958 to new call letters, WECT. Also in 1958, WECT got a new face, Jim Burns.
It's difficult for me to believe sometimes, but I've been at WECT for nearly 26 years. It wasn't long after I started that we moved from the studio on Princess Street to our present home on Shipyard Boulevard. Of course, the building wasn't nearly as large as it is now. We've added to it several times.
It wasn't long after we moved to Shipyard Boulevard that Jimmy Craig, an account executive at WECT, had the idea to bring the USS North Carolina to Wilmington. Through Craig, WECT became involved in the fundraising efforts. We broadcast programs about the battleship and the progress being made to bring her to Wilmington. Less than 2 weeks before the battleship was scheduled to arrive, Craig and John McNeil, director of photography at WECT, were taking off to photograph the site where the ship would be berthed when their plane crashed.
Good God,
they took off and tried to climb too high. I guess we may never know. But they lost altitude and just came down and crashed. The plane is on fire now. We just hope that everyone stays out of the way. There goes the fire truck. We hope that they'll be able to get someone out of there alive. Everything is on fire.
I don't know where it is. Bob! Bob! Can you hear me, Bob? Can they hear me?
No, they can't.
Tell them John was on that plane, McNeil.
John and Bill Wood were on that plane.
And I think CD was.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt this program again to bring you a special emergency bulletin. Blood is needed immediately at James Walker Hospital by blood donators. If you desire to donate blood to this emergency, please report to James Walker Hospital immediately and donate blood. Thank you very much.
Both men died from their injuries. Jimmy Craig never saw the result of his efforts on the North Carolina's behalf. WECT broadcast the battleship's arrival in October. The USS North Carolina has become a very special part of Wilmington. I think Jimmy Craig would be pleased.
When you think of WECT, you more than likely think of your favorite television programs. Well, over the years, WECT has brought hundreds of shows into your home. We've carried shows from all three commercial networks. And here are some of the shows that you've enjoyed on WECT.
Touch ground on an international runway. Japan. space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Its 5-year mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
Now we're talking.
How about this, sucker?
Aren't they a wonderful couple?
Yes, we're so fair. We're living in the USA. Anything you want, we got it right here in the USA.
One of the most exciting things to happen at WECT was the arrival in 1968 of our two new color studio cameras. Some network shows had been broadcast in color for several years, but now all of our local programming and commercials were in color as well. Not long after that, a 5-year-old dream came true for WECT.
In 1969, the Federal Communications Commission granted us permission to move our transmitter to White Lake, North Carolina. We'd been negotiating the move since 1964, and on several occasions given up hope that the move would ever take place. But in 1969, WECT became one of the first television stations in the eastern half of the United States to build and broadcast from a 2,000-foot tower.
The new tower almost doubled our coverage area, bringing us hundreds of thousands of new viewers.
For the first time, we were able to reach Fayetteville, Lumberton, and Myrtle Beach, South Carolina with a strong, clear signal.
It was the beginning of a new era in the life of WECT.
News has always been a most important part of WECT. Each of us has brought you either news, sports, or weather during our tenure here, and Ken Murphy has brought you all three.
Not all at once, though. I was hired to do sports and weather for the 11 o'clock news back in 1965. Since we live on the coast, weather often makes the news. In fact, one of the first big stories covered by Channel 6 News was the aftermath of Hurricane Hazel in 1954. 6 months after we went on the air, the storm hit, causing tremendous property damage in Long, Carolina, and Wrightsville beaches. In 1954, there was little advance warning that a hurricane was about to hit. Today, though, thanks to weather satellites, radar, and computers, we're able to track hurricanes and predict with some accuracy when and where they'll come ashore. WECT broadcasts weather advisories whenever potentially dangerous weather threatens part of our coverage area. In 1956, WECT began airing Douglas Edwards' 15-minute nightly newscast. We carried the CBS newscast until 1961, when we began carrying NBC's Huntley-Brinkley Report. Wilmington native David Brinkley and Chet Huntley dominated television news for many years, and their popularity was one of the reasons network news was expanded to half an hour.
Thanks for these years of happy association, and for being such an easy colleague to work with, and for all the kindnesses.
Good night, Chet.
While Huntley and Brinkley reported news of the nation and world, WECT brought you news of the Carolinas. Your SO reporter was a nightly feature, as were sports and weather. In the 50s and 60s, stories for WECT news were shot on film. This film had to be developed and edited before it could go on the air. Newscasts were primitive compared to newscasts today, but we still brought you spectacular and evocative images of the events of the time.
My poor little children,
will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Former hostages and their families boarded buses headed for West Point. They were probably astounded at what they saw. Crowds lining the entire 17-mile route. A profusion of yellow ribbons, flags, and welcome home signs.
It begins with the Deputy Chief of Staff, Mike Deaver, and a few agents coming out of the hotel smiling, ready to go. And then suddenly, there is a gunfire. The assailant is accosted by half a dozen lawmen.
With this ring,
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
To hit the car as quick as he could so he could get out of the way of it. And I pulled out and went down the road here about 1,000 yards and it hit us full blast.
We lost our home and our furniture, but God saved our lives.
When I started at WECT, the 6 o'clock news consisted actually of three separate shows. Each had its own title and opening and closing theme music. Carolina's Reporter came first, then Let's Look at Sports, and finally, the weather. The news block was like that until around 1970. That year, the real growth of the news department started. As late as 1967, there were only three of us in news, a photographer, a reporter, and me. When Fayetteville and Lumberton became part of our coverage area in 1969, we decided to include news of that region in our newscast. What began as a report on undeveloped film mailed from Fayetteville evolved into regular live broadcast during the 6 o'clock news. We also broadcast regularly from Myrtle Beach. The biggest single advance in television news in the past 10 years has been the development of electronic news gathering, or ENG. These smaller videotape cameras and recorders make it possible for us to go to the scene of news events and bring them to you as they happen. To facilitate our coverage of events, we have an ENG van, our live action cam. ENG makes it possible for us to cover more news in a greater area, and as a result, the news department has grown by leaps and bounds. We now have 20 people on our news staff. Today, we bring you more than 9 hours of locally produced news every week, in addition to the news from NBC and the cable news network. Our commitment to local news is only one way we try to meet the needs of our viewers. In October 1982, WECT began broadcasting 24 hours a day. WECT takes an active part in the community, too. In 1982, we made a contribution to Pembroke State University to help launch its television department.
In making the announcement at a Friday morning press conference, General Manager C.D. Martin said the donation, which includes two fully operational studio color cameras and a remote production van, would, as he put it, not only help the PSU program, but would also benefit those students training for a broadcasting career.
We also sponsor events for worthwhile causes, including the mini marathon and the Lung Association bike track. Our programming is another way we promote the communities in our viewing area. Our Carolina Sampler series looks at interesting towns and places of historical significance in our area.
Carolina Sampler, presented by WECT.
The past 30 years have been exciting ones for us at WECT, and we're looking forward to serving the coastal Carolinas for many years to come. We'd like to thank you for the support you've provided us through the years, and we promise to continue bringing you the very best in news, sports, and entertainment.
ECT, there, be there. You can see anything you want to see there.
Any organization is only as good as the individuals working for it. One of our greatest strengths at WECT is our employees.
But you've got to be there. Right here, WECT, be there. You've got to be there. Yeah, you've just got to be there. You'll feel free there. Get the weather play by play. All the news that's new today. It'll be you and me there. See what you want to see there. WECT, there, be there. It'll be you and me there. Gotcha, covered, Carolina. See what you want to see there.